Good morning, Lakeside. There are still some people gathering from the lobby, but we'll get started with announcements this morning. Happy Lord's Day. Beautiful day out. The sign-up sheet for snacks only has today on it. There's nobody signed up for next week or any others. If you like our snacks in the morning, this would be a good time when you leave to go to the clipboard out there. Not next week because we have Church Without Walls next week, but the week after that we need snacks. Best choice labels. I was asked to remind everybody to bring your best choice labels in. There's a jar out on one of the window ledges. Where's JJ at? Okay. JJ's grandfather passed away. He's one of our youth who's been here a very long time. If you would please keep the grandfather in your prayers this week as the family goes through. And keep our whole church. We seem to have just a lot of things going on right now. The rest of the announcements are in red on the bulletin. And when we're done with worship singing, today we will have Denny from the Gideons here, and he will do a presentation. That is one of the missions that we support. When we get done, there will be baskets at both doors on the way out for a love offering for them. If you'd pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for all you do, what we know, what we don't know. Thank you for just everything, Father. You love us, you support us. Father, we want to offer pleasant worship to you today. Father God, thank you for being sovereign over everything and taking our thread in that tapestry and weaving it in the way that you need it, Father. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Well, let's go ahead and stand up and get ready to worship. So I love music, a lot of different types of music, especially if it's got a really good beat. But worship is something more than just singing along to some words. It's more than just tapping a foot. Even when we're incorporating our whole body, which God loves us to worship with everything that we have. Right now, God, we want to come to you to offer more than just a song. We want to come to you offering our praise, our adoration. God, I want to adore you with everything that I have. I want to so focus on you that all the hurts that I'm going through seem less. That God, that you are my joy. You are everything that fills my sight. I want to give everything to you. And that started because you gave everything to us. You sacrificed your son on the cross so that we can freely come to you, that we can offer our worship and praise anywhere, that we can have a church that's bigger than a building. We can be a body, we can be the church and offer our praises up to you. Thank you, Lord, that we can come boldly before you. We can lift our hands, we can lift our voices, we can have our joy, Lord, in you.
Runs dry. Drink of the water. Come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners. Come find his mercy. Come to the table. He will satisfy. Taste of his goodness. Find what you're looking for.
Honor and all of the glory. God, it started with you, and you You. I don't know what brought each of you here today, but I know that God is directing all of our steps, and He is directing our steps back to Him. It's all about Him. It started, and it's going to end with Him, too. He has a perfect plan. God, thank you so much for including us in that. You want us to be a part of your kingdom work. That means stepping outside of ourselves and focusing on you, your will, your love. God, the image that comes to my mind is like binoculars. Depending on what we look at, that's all that we see. All that we see when we're looking through those binoculars. And God, I want them pointed at you, and I want to keep adjusting that focus so that you and you alone are what becomes clear in my eyes. I want to be so focused on you that when I pull those binoculars around to see the people, to see the hurt, to see the joys, God, I have it on the lens of God, the God lens I'm seeing everything through. Thank you, Lord, that you are changing us. You are changing our eyes. You are changing our hearts. Come set your rule and reign. Hearts again, increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church, and we need your power.
Thank you.
this earth.
God, it is all for your glory and all for your honor. Lord, you want us to praise. You want us to praise, God. It is a beautiful thing. We get to focus on you, but God, it also confuses the enemy. Lord, I want to use this beautiful, beautiful thing to confuse the heck out of the enemy.
Hold.
Father, you're worthy. Thank you, Lord. Yes. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Thank you. Thank you, God. Yes, it is all for your glory, all for your honor. Thank you, Lord, that we get to be here and stand in your presence once again. Lord, I know that you're with us always, but especially worshiping with my brothers and sisters. Father, oh, I get to see in the lives changed, not just feel it in my own heart. Thank you, God, the life changer, the maker. The beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. We're going to start and end with you. Thank you, Lord. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hello. Have you ever been planning and praying about and just know this is what you need to do, and just hours before the Lord says, no, you don't need to do that? Well, that's me this morning. But he's given me something else, and I pray it's from the Lord and not from me. But it is offering time. We get to honor, worship God with the offering and tithes. If you're visiting with us this morning, we're not expecting an offering from you. We'd just love for you to sit back, enjoy the service, be blessed, just like you've been here today blesses us. There's different ways to give offering up on the screen. Also, in the bulletin that you received when you came in the entry, there's directions in there about how to give, and offering plates by the rear exits. And just do what God lays on your heart there. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for each one that's here. We thank you for the hearts that are touched and blessed because of offerings and tithes that people like each of us give to further your work and provide this house for us to worship you in. We thank you for it and ask you to bless it in Jesus' name. As we go into communion time, we do practice open communion here at Lakeside. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're more than welcome to participate with us. There's communion cups by both back exits. There's also cups here in front, and there's gluten-free cups with the gluten-free wafers up front. So if you'd like to get those. Excuse me. The scriptures tell us we're to examine ourselves before we take communion. And Jesus, got ahead of myself. If you have young children, please make sure that they understand, because we are to examine ourselves and be a believer in Christ and have an understanding of what that communion means. So we need to make sure if we have young children that they understand that. The first line of the last song we just sang, worthy, worthy is the Lamb that was slain. He was so worthy, and we're unworthy, and his worthy blood covers our sins so that we can have that salvation and be a part of his family. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus implemented communion with breaking bread and drinking the cup with his disciples, his close friends. And that bread and wine is representative of his broken, scourged, bleeding body that died on the wooden cross. Horrible death. But that blood on that cross covers our sins if we just accept it. And it's that easy. It really is. All we have to do is believe it. It's free. And accept it. If you've done that, let's all share together. And you know what? I need a cup. On the top, you peel back that first cellophane, and that will free up the wafer, representing the blood, the body of Christ. Father, thank you. You sent your Son, the only Son you have, and gave him for us. And help us to accept and honor and cherish that sacrifice as we partake in your communion today. Amen. The broken body of Christ. And peel back the next layer, revealing the juice, representative of Christ's blood that was shed so that we could have life and a relationship with God like Jesus had with his Father.
So this week we're going to have the Gideons International be speaking. So it's Denzel that's going to be coming up. And so I just wanted to be able to let you guys know, you've always interacted with Gideon Bibles in different places. But the first time that I ever interacted with a Gideon's Bible was a little pocket Bible that was given to me whenever I was a wrestler. That thing stunk. But it was highly used. It was a thick, I remember it had Psalms. It was the first time I ever read Psalms. And I could get my feelings out. Just like go, okay, David didn't look crazy. God was pleased with that. And I'm not crazy having so many emotions. And so the greatest thing that I could say is that thing stayed in my pocket all the time. All the time. And I sweat all the time in Florida. But here's the thing. It was highly used. I'm very grateful that we have people that are after God's word, because you can go ahead and come up, Denzel. We have people that are so passionate about God's word because God's word will never come back void, ever, ever, ever. So can I pray for you really quick, and then I will let you, oh. Good?
Yes.
Good. Father God, I thank you so much for what you are doing in the Gideons, and I pray that we get to see three times even more, that we get to see people get what you wanted them to get. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you for the privilege of being here again at Lakeside. You know, I've been here several times. I feel like I'm home. You know, nothing wrong with that. Before I get started on the Gideon ministry, we want to show you a video. First of a lady that was an atheist and what happened to her life and her family's with that one little Bible. And I want you to take special attention to this Bible. She stole it. You know, and I've heard that said many times lately, but Gideon's, you don't steal a Bible. We want you to have a Bible. That's what we want. For each person to have a Bible, kids, 5 years, fifth graders, and so on, we want those kids to have them. But before I better shut for get into the video. Go ahead with that, if you could.
Good evening, and welcome to my home state of Georgia. I am so happy that you are here, and I am so honored that I was asked to be here with you and to speak and share my testimony. I was raised by an incredible family here in Georgia, a wonderful mother and a wonderful father. I can't remember an evening or a special holiday when we did not have complete strangers sitting at the table with us. During holiday seasons, we would have people who had been thrown out of their homes either because of drug addiction or alcoholism. Or later, when in the 80s, when the AIDS epidemic hit, my mother took in people with AIDS and took care of them. When I was in high school, we had a runaway living with us. My mother took in almost anybody, and she actually loved them. She treated them as family. Now, this might be very common for Christians, and many Christians around the world might do something similar. But see, my family, we're all atheists, every one of us. My brother, my sister, my parents, my aunts and uncles, and my grandparents. We didn't own a Bible, we didn't listen to Christian programming, and we didn't go to churches. In growing up, I had a wonderful mother, very talented. She was an artist. And as part of her talents, it enabled us to travel to all kinds of galleries and museums and travel throughout the United States. And so, of course, we stayed in a lot of hotels. One evening, after we had wrapped up visiting a hotel, visiting a museum, we stayed in a hotel, and that evening, my mom wanted to go out to dinner, and I said, you know, Mom, I'm a little tired. I was 14, and it was 1974, and I said, would you mind going out and getting something? I'm just going to stay around here. I stayed in that evening, and I looked around the hotel room for something to read, and lo and behold, at the foot of the bed, on a bench seat, was a little red Gideon's Bible. Now, I had never read a Bible before. I'm not sure at that age that I had ever even seen one, and I had never heard the gospel story. So I picked up that book, and I began to read just like any other 14-year-old would. I opened up to page 1, paragraph 1, sentence 1, and that's where I began to read. It took about 15 or 20 minutes for my mother to come back with dinner, and in that time, I had read several chapters of the Bible. And I decided right then and there in that hotel room that that was the most incredible work of fiction I had ever read. And so the next morning, as we were packing to leave the hotel, I took that little red Gideon's Bible and I hid it in my suitcase. Now let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, even a 14-year-old atheist knows that it's not right to steal. But I did it anyway. And years later, my sweet husband would say to me, honey, that's not really stealing. The Gideons want you to have that Bible. But I didn't know that. I took that little red Gideon's Bible home, and for the next 4 years while I was in high school, while my friends were out doing what teenagers typically do, I was behind a locked door and often under my covers with a flashlight reading that Bible. And I started, as I said, from page 1, sentence 1, and continued to read through. And by my senior year in high school, I had finally reached the scripture in the New Testament that says, ask and it will be given, seek and you will find, knock and the door shall be opened. And so that night, I closed my eyes and I said, God, I don't believe in you. No one in my family does. But if you're really there, just show me. Just show me and I'll believe. And I had read so many incredible tales about burning bushes and stars at night that I expected something like that to happen. And when it didn't, I was very disappointed and I thought, well, this is a wonderful book, but it's not for me and God does not exist. That fall in 1978, my mother, who was my best friend, helped me pack for college and I could not find a way to sneak that little red Bible into my suitcase. And so off I went to the University of Georgia right down the road to start my academic career. That fall, as God would have it, across the hall from me was a young lady by the name of Susie Colley. And I knew within a very short period of time that she was a Christian. Now, up until that point, I'm not sure I'd met very many. Certainly no one had ever shared the gospel story with me, and I was 18 years old, living in the United States. But I knew that Susie was a Christian because she was just like the people in the book of Acts. She talked about God and prayed to God, but what was more amazing is that God talked to her, and she told me about it. And so that fall, she took me to a Christian concert at the University of Georgia, and that night I heard the gospel story, and I gave my heart to Jesus Christ and my life. Now, I went to the front. I went to the front and told the minister that I wanted to be baptized in water. And he tried to explain to me that on a Saturday night, most of the churches are locked, and there wasn't really a place that he could take me that had a baptismal font. But that didn't matter to me. You see, by that time, I had read the New Testament. I knew what the book of Acts said, and I had read all the stories in the Gospels. And I insisted I was not leaving that student center without being baptized. So bless his little heart. They opened up someone's house and took me over, and I was baptized with water and filled with the Holy Spirit in a bathtub. Now, as we say in the South, there just ain't nothing like a born-again Christian, or a born-again atheist, too. And so what happened was, for the next several years, I began to share with everyone I came in contact with the story that I had never heard. I told them about Jesus, and I told them about the Bible. And my entire family, within the next 2 years, except for my mother and my brother, became born-again Christians, radically changed born-again Christians. So now I need to fast forward to 5 short years ago. I received, sitting in the building, not far from where you sit, a call stating that I needed to come to the hospital. My mother had been diagnosed with inoperable cancer, and we found out that she had only 2 to 3 months to live. In a courtyard at her home here in Atlanta, Georgia, I sat down with her a week after her diagnosis, and she began to do what the doctors had told her to do, and that was get her affairs in order. And she looked at me and she said, "Carrie, I hope I have been a good mother. I hope you have been proud of me." And I said, "Well, Mom, why would you say that? I've had an incredible childhood. I've had an incredible relationship with you." And she said, "Because we don't believe the same way. I know you're a Christian, and I'm still an atheist after all these years. And I know that it's disappointing, and I know that it must affect the way that you see me." And I said, "Mom, I'm sorry that I've given you that impression, because no, let me tell you how God sees you." I said, "There's a story in the New Testament about a Good Samaritan. When all the believers and the godly people had left the downtrodden and a man that was beaten up in a gutter and would not help him, a Good Samaritan came along, someone who was not one of the faithful, and they took care of that man in the gutter. God loves you. God loves your heart, and God loves how you served his people." And I said, "It's such a beautiful story. I just wish I had a Bible that I could share with you so I could read it to you." And she said, "Well, honey, I don't know how I have this, but if you'll go into my bedroom and get up on a chair and reach into the back on the bookcase, I think you'll find a Bible there. I'm not really sure where it came from or what it's doing there, but I think there's one there nonetheless." And so that evening, 5 years ago, I got up on a chair and I reached into the back on the top of the bookcase, and out I pulled that little red Gideon's Bible. Well, of course, I had to, at that point, confess to my mother that I'd stolen it. And I tried to explain to her what my husband said, and that it's not really stealing, but she was having nothing of that. And she said, "I really want to keep that Bible, Carrie, so you're going to have to call the Gideons, and you're going to have to ask them for us to keep it." And that started my relationship, formally, with the Gideons International. A very sweet, kind, faithful brother named Reed Calloway dedicated this Bible to my mother. And in less than a year later, beating all of the odds that the doctors gave her, my mother gave her heart to the Lord. And as I said before, amen. As I said before, there just ain't nothing like a born-again atheist. So she began to share the love of God with everyone she knew. My mother went to be with the Lord 2 years ago. During her last days, as her health was ailing and she was in the hospital, people came from all over the United States that were lifelong friends to visit her. One of those people was a little Jewish psychiatrist from Virginia. And she stayed with us that week, and she took me aside at one point and she said, "Carrie, I've known your mother almost her entire life, and I've known you. Now, I've always noticed that there's something really different about you. But in all the years I've known your mother, there's something really different about her now, too. And I can't figure it out. What is going on? Tell me about your faith." And so I looked at her and I said, "Shelley, it all started when I was 14 years old and I stole a little red Gideon's Bible." And she went, "Oh!" And I said, well, Shelly, you know, it's not really stealing. I've learned that by now. And Shelly said, that's not why I gasped. She said, you see, I'm a psychiatrist in a hospital. And 2 weeks ago, I almost stole a little white Gideon's Bible. And I said, well, they really do want you to have those, Shelly. My mother passed away 2 years ago on New Year's Day. And within 30 days, I received this email from the little Jewish psychiatrist, Shelly. She had walked out in the back of her yard. She had closed her eyes, and in this, she details how she accepted Jesus and asked him to be Lord and Savior of her life. I want to thank you. I want to thank all of you for your service. I want to thank you for your role in fulfilling the Great Commission. I cannot tell you how the devotion of Gideon's in the past and how your devotion has changed my life. Yes, God is always faithful, but he is faithful through his people. You have an incredible ministry. You and the Gideons International will be forever woven in my faith story and in the story of my family. I will bring you up to date on my brother because some people who know me have asked. My brother will not step foot in a church. After I came to know the Gideons, several faithful brothers called him and tried to share their faith with him. And he would call me and say it's a waste of time. 2 months ago, I heard from my brother. And he said that he had gone to church for the first time. Your faithfulness has meant everything to my family. Where most families have old Bibles that they'll keep forever as their family Bibles, my Red Gideons will be our family Bible. We will pass this down, and we will always tell every member of our family about your faithfulness and your service. Thank you for being here, and thank you for your service.
If you can kindly picture in your mind, that's the reason we pass out Bibles. That's the reason we put them in motel rooms. You know, we've done that recently all in our area. Last night I was at Monette at an event passing out Bibles. Friday night I was at Aurora passing out Bibles. We had Friday night, the rodeo was in Cassville. We had a couple there giving out Bibles. They give out 225 Bibles at the rodeo. You know, where there's people need the Lord. That's the reason we pass them out, and what a blessing it is to be a Gideon and get the privilege of doing that, taking them to the schools. You know, and not every school we get to give them out per se, one by one, but Southwest at Washburn and Wheaton and Exeter, we get to go in and give those out. We set us up a table. You know, as we do that and the kids come by, three or four of us will be there. And the teacher, I'm always amazed, they always make sure that fifth grader comes by that table and gets him a Bible. You know, in Wheaton, I've gone and the principal, I know her, and she'll take me. She said, Denny, I want to take you back into the classroom. She had two classrooms. She took me back to both of them. I said a few moments, said a few words, and I said, if the kids, you get a Bible and mom and dad don't have one, share it with mom and dad. You know, God's word in Isaiah 55:11, it tells us his word will not return void. It will accomplish that which he desires. It will touch people's lives. In Hebrews 4:12, it tells us it's sharp and powerful. It penetrates, it reaches people where they want to be reached or not. You know, where they want to be. In Romans, it tells us, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All, no one is exempt. You know, mom can't make that decision for you. Grandpa can't. Grandma or anybody else. You have to do it yourself. And so you have to read God's word personally. You know, and then there it also says, John 3:16, for God so loved the world, every one of us, that he gave his only son to die for us, didn't we? We celebrated that not long ago on Easter time. But now he is risen. He is risen. He is alive forevermore. You know, and this word will not go void. It will not change. You know, I think of mom and dad that have gone on, you know, and they're in heaven now. I can't think. I'm glad I was raised in a Christian home. And you know, I always found out it was best to get along with dad if you did what dad said. You know, I'd like to tell you a testimony of a couple moved in next door to another family. And, of course, they didn't know this family weren't Christians or anything, but this family must have been Gideons because they offered a nightstand to this family next door. It went into the older son's bedroom right beside his bed. And, of course, you know what he found in the drawer, don't you? That's what you find, a Gideon Bible. That's what we hope they find them in motels and everywhere, is a Gideon Bible in that nightstand. And that older boy got to reading that, and he said something to his dad one day. He said, "Dad, there's a church down the street here a little ways. I wonder if we could..." He said, "Now, son, hold it." He said, "That's just fairy tales and stories. There's nothing to it. Don't pay attention to it." But big son didn't do that. He kept reading. And he was reading, and the first thing he decided to do, he said, "Well, I'm going to slip off and go down there myself." So he went to going down there and got to reading God's Word, you know, and the Lord changed his life. He accepted the Lord as his Savior, and he acted different. And his little brother got saying, he said, "You've been going off down there like Dad said not to do, didn't you?" "Yeah, you want to go with me?" So the little brother went to going down there, and they both went to going to that church down the street there a little ways. And time went on, and Mom and Dad noticed the boys were acting different. They were, I guess, more obedient. I don't know, but they didn't listen first, did they? But still, anyway, this was for a purpose, and I think it was in God's will for that Bible to be in that nightstand at that particular time. Because you know what happened when Dad found out the boys were going down there? You know what Dad said? He said, "Mom and Dad's going to go down there with you." Now, if that hadn't been what they were supposed to do, you know, although the boys done wrong, Mom and Dad got to going down there with the boys to church. You know what happens when they go to church a lot, don't you? And to get to reading God's Word, they accept the Lord as their Savior. You know, the whole family there, just like this lady's family here, accepted the Lord. And I'd like to tell you about a prisoner. Gideons were going down through a prison and handing Bibles out in the prison cells. The guys were reaching out and taking the Bible, and this one kid stuck his hand out the Bible, and when he got it, he just throwed it over on the floor. He didn't need it. He didn't have, I started to say he didn't have time, but he had lots of time. But you know, he said, "I can't figure out what happened," but he said, "That Bible laid over there, and something told me to go over and get it." Now, what was that? Was that God's still small voice? Go say, "Go pick that up." You know, God's Word won't return void. He goes over and picks that up and goes to reading. It changed his life. That's the reason we hand them out. That's the reason we go to schools and events and different things that we can go to, like a truck and tractor pull. I went to Cassville one, set up a table, give out Bibles there as people pass by. Went to Pier City, truck and tractor pull, and they said, "Well, it's a little noisy, but you can go on the other side of the track and set up your table." And as kids and adults come by, anybody wanted a Bible, I'd give them a Bible, a New Testament. You know, and three kids come by in a few moments and a little later, and then I give those three kids a Bible. And a little bit later, those three came back. They had a friend that needed a Bible, so I give that friend a Bible. And directly all four of them came back. They had a friend that needed a Bible. I said, "Just keep bringing your friends. Come on, bring them on." You know, so I give them Bibles. And that's what we try to do, is we do that. Like the rodeo, just Friday night, they give out 225 Bibles. But you know, we never know maybe what happened or what happened when that Bible got to their home or in their pocket or whatever. We don't know this side of heaven, but we will find out one of these days. You know, and since 1908, when Gideons first started putting Bibles, they started in Superior, Montana. They got three guys, got 25 Bibles, and they got to putting those in a motel, and that's the first thing they did, because businessmen, that was a railroad area, and that's where businessmen travel by railroad, so they went they'd stop at these big cities and sell their wares or their business or whatever they were selling. But they put those in Superior, Montana, 25 Bibles, and we're still doing that. You know, and I think what a privilege that is to continue to do that. And if you go to a motel and there's not a Bible in it, when you go to the desk, tell them, hey, where's my Gideon Bible at? My Bible's not in this motel room right here. And there is some places we don't get to do that. But since about last year, Gideons have placed like 90 million Bibles around the world. We're at 200 in 200 plus countries. And since 1908 till last June, which just started a year ago, Gideons have placed around the world 2.5 billion Bibles around the world. And you know what? You know what our goal is? More. We want to put more out there. We want to put them in everybody's hands. And we're in 200 plus countries, and you think, man, how many more countries are they? But there is some places that we're not in, some countries we're not in. And matter of fact, in September, our Gideons are meeting in Branson at a retreat. There's six states of us meet there, and then after that retreat, they're going to go to St. Louis with 75,000 Bibles and place them in the St. Louis area, in motels, doctor's offices, every place they can put Bibles. They've done that 2-3 years ago. Time gets by. But anyway, and then in the spring, they're going back to Kansas City and do the same thing again, putting Bibles and new. And we hope, and like in this September, we'll be going to that retreat in Branson again, and there'll be six states of us there. Last year, we had we met on Monday morning. Sundays, we do what we're doing here. I get my head ahead of myself. Sundays, we do what I'm doing right here. They schedule churches within an hour and a half of Branson, and we go to speak at those. And then on Monday morning, we meet at the Toy Museum, and we gather there, and there was 29 of us last year. I took two other guys with me, and we take Bibles, and we go to motels and check those rooms. And they had called the motels and took care of that and had it arranged that we'd be 42 of them looking for us. So we went from room to room. We took our Bibles on them little carts, and we checked those rooms. And we get to there, and the housekeeping sticks that card in the door, opens the door. She said, there it is. Help yourself. So we look through there and make sure there's a Bible in there. And if there's not, we hope somebody has stole it and took it with them. That's what we hope. Somebody took it with them personally and took it home with them and shared it with their family. But you know, as that happens, the Lord wins people to Christ. And that's what we're after. Men, women, boys, and girls won to the Lord. And so they're in church somewhere, we hope. I go to churches, I see you got a pretty good crowd today. There is a few empty pews that could be filled. But you know, all of our churches need people, don't they? You know, and how the Lord needs witnesses. And you as a church, you're witnessing out in the world, out in your community each week as you go. You know, you don't hide your Christianity from them, do you? Can you show it to them by the way you live, by your actions and the things you do? If you go fishing, even, you know, whatever. Show Jesus wherever you're at. And I think of that parent that wouldn't let his boy go. And I think of another testimony where a couple Gideons had tried. They was in Madagascar, and they were going to go back to a school, and the schools weren't necessarily in town. The school was way back up in the mountains. And it was a dirt road or a muddy road, and they decided they would take a case of Bibles, each one of them, back there, and they would take them to that school. So they took off, they got them a bicycle, and they got down to creek, and they was afraid to cross the creek with a bicycle, so they just waded the creek, took a case on his shoulder, and the other guy a case on his shoulder, and they walked back to the school. They got back there, they had 100, they gave out 172 Bibles, 162 students, teachers, and principal, and so on. They give out 172 Bibles and walk back and cross the creek and back home. But they got back home at night at 10:30. But, you know, dedication is another thing about us Gideons. We're determined. You know, and as we go to those motels like Branson or wherever, In our area, we've been to the Wrong River Resort. We've been to the Fishing for Men's Resort. We've been to the Budget Inn. We've been to the Motel 6. And we've checked all those places. The Budget Inn said the kids had mangled up their Bibles and tore them up. And they took them out of the rooms. And we found out. And I said, I sent Ed out there and we put 20 new Bibles in the rooms. You know, and I said, if the kids mar them up, I said, we'll pick them up. I said, don't throw them away. Because I said, we take those Bibles and Motel Bibles, we can take the hard cover off and put a soft cover on there. And we've been connected. The Kimmerling City Camp is doing that. They're taking the hard cover off, putting a soft cover on, and taking them to the Fulton Penitentiary in Fulton. We're not burning them or throwing them away. God's Word will reach people. And there's people in the prisons that need the Lord also. You know, as we do that, they took 700, 800 up there at a time. And they did that not long ago because I've been down there and I've checked with them. But you know, there's people in them places too. And we know there's people in the sound of our voice. If we could get outside the door, there'd be somebody that needed the Lord. But that's what we're doing with Bibles. We're trying to put them where people can get them and read them because His Word will not return void. And what a blessing it is. And I could go on and go on about testimonies, and I hear it, and I read so many testimonies where it's been drug addicts or situations like that, where a kid, even one yesterday, I said it, or at Friday night at Aurora, I was visiting with a young guy. He had been cigarettes, drugs, and so on, and he's in the rehab type thing, going to church and going to church and going to church and trying to get away from those situations, get his life where he needs to be. And I know there's people around us, and I'm thank the Lord that I was raised in a Christian home. And what a blessing it was. We went to church Sunday morning, Sunday night. Dad didn't go Wednesday night. We lived on a farm. We had cows to milk. But anyway, we had things to do. But you know, the Lord leads us to give Bibles and give more. You pray for us that we can continue to do that. Like in September, we'd be back down to motels again. The camp down there rigs up a map, like Gretna Road from Strip that way and Strip that way, you know, and we go down motel to motel. And last year we even went to an RV park, and I thought, what are we going to an RV park for? But I didn't realize they had rental cabins there also, and they had 10 rental cabins. They gave us the keys to those, and we went and checked all those cabins for Bibles too. So pray for us, our ministry. We pray it gets bigger and gets more out there in the world, because America needs the Lord. There's no doubt about it. America is on the downhill slope, I'm afraid. But I don't see it that much that way. I'm looking at it through the Lord's eyes. I'm looking up. Because He's in control, and He will reign. And we will win if we accept the Lord as our Savior. We're the winners. We're the winners. And another ministry we have is the card ministry, and he's got a short video of that, I think. The card ministry is a card rack that you have out there. You use those cards instead of flowers and a loss of a loved one or a relative or something. You can use those and give Bibles instead of flowers. So 5 motel Bibles, $25. But I think the price has gone up a little bit, but what hasn't? But, you know, I haven't. I think it's $650 is for a full Bible now is what it is for a motel Bible or something. But we appreciate you, and you use those cards for your benefit. If you get low, we'll put some more in there. So go ahead and show that if you would right there.
Give a Gideon card, the greeting card that changes everything. Gideon cards are beautiful expressions of faith, hope, and love. Unlike other greeting cards, Gideon cards are actually free. And when you give a Gideon card, you donate scriptures that God can use to change lives for eternity.
I picked up a Gideon's Bible and read it and became immediately peaceful in a way that I had never experienced at the time.
Each year, Gideons place some 90 million scriptures into the hands of people in over 195 countries, all over the world. Gideon cards, send the word, and change a life. Visit sendtheword.org today. Gideon Cards, send the word and change a life.
Attention this morning, and the Lord bless you as we worship together. And I hope I've said something. If you have a question, well, look me up after the service here. But I love the Gideon ministry. Pray for us that we can continue. And I wish we could get back in all the schools, but it probably ain't going to happen. Oh, ye of little faith.
If anybody wants to come up with prayer or just for anything, please come up. We'll be here while everybody's worshiping.
All right, Lord, we want to come before you again and choose to use this time to lay down anything heavy that we're carrying. God, you want to take this. We want to take whatever we're carrying. You said that your yoke is easy and your burden is light. And part of that is because you're willing to take the stuff that we're dealing with, Lord, and you're willing to carry that. You want that weight.
Overwhelming, never-ending, reckless. kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down.
In all of this. Thank you, God, that you died for us, that we can come to you freely, we can lay our burdens down, and we can stand up stronger and freer from the weight that Satan wants to keep us down with. He knows our weaknesses, God, but in you we have strength. We don't have to focus on our weakness. We don't have to focus on all of that that Satan wants to use against you and your plan. God, we are going to lift our voices. God, we are going to praise you in the storm, and Satan is going to be so confused. He is going to be baffled as to how we can keep lifting your name high, how we can keep lifting our arms and our hands up to you, our voices and our eyes. God, you are our freedom. Thank you so much that we get to offer that, to show other people the freedom that we are living with. Not just on Sunday morning, but every moment of every day. Satan, you will not be victorious. Jesus paid the cost. God, the final victory is won. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We have freedom. We have freedom. It's in your name. Amen.
Everybody sit down for just a second. And then, there's been a lot of things going on in the last 2 weeks. A lot of stuff. And so there's been deaths, and there's been pain, and there's been a lot of other stuff. So what we wanted to do is just pray together and be able just to lift up people. So if you know anybody that is struggling, just put a hand on them and pray for them too, because we have just have a lot of things going on. But I am very grateful for this church. This is a praying church. So what we're going to do is we're going to just pray. And you already know about Alicia and Jake with Keaton passing away, an eighth grader going into ninth grade. And so that's one of the ones that we're praying for. So just put your hand out and just we're praying. God, I thank you so much that in pain, you're merciful. And God, in mourning, you bring peace. And so, God, I pray that you just give an extra amount of just space in you and with everything that's going on, that they can be in your presence and know that you got it all under control. God, I am so grateful that Keaton is up there with you. And, God, I pray that you just allow both of those boys, their families, to be healed. But also, God, there's some pain in this room. God, heal every person that's hurting, even if they don't look like it. Heal them right now in Jesus' name. And then, God, I pray that you do something that only you can get credit for in those painful times. In Jesus' name, amen. Today is birthday. So at Flat Creek, if anybody's interested in going to Flat Creek, there's a group that's going to be going over there. I am very grateful for this body of believers. God is moving a whole bunch of stuff. Even if there's a lot of things going on, there's a lot of good, godly things going on. May you just keep on keeping your eyes towards Christ. Have a blessed day.